Good morning, everyone. Good morning in the building. Good morning to everyone online. Welcome to church. Please stand to your feet and let's sing some songs of worship to God. Come on. our praise, God. Magnify you this morning, Lord. We don't just lift our voices, but we lift our hearts, Father. We seek an exchange with you this morning. Oh, have your way, Spirit of God. Speak to us, move in this place this morning.
Yeah.
riches of your life. Always be enough. Everything we need is in you, Lord. Down in worship to sing the song of ages to the Lamb, and all who've gone before us and all who will believe will sing the song of ages to the Lamb. Your name is the highest, your name is the greatest, your name stands above them all thrones and dominions, all powers and positions. Your name stands above them all, and the angels cry, holy, all creations cry. Your name. You will always be. Come on, sing it out. You will always be. How big is your God? You feel that you've reached the limit of what I can do, of what I can say, of who I am? I am limitless. I can take you further. I can take you higher. I can take you into realms you've never dreamt of. I can, because I am the Holy God. I am the Great One. There is no limit to me. Search me, find me, and you will see that I am great. I am a great God. Don't limit me. Don't leave your God as a small God, but see the riches that I have for you. They will never end. They will never reach a limit. Just search and you will find.
Just take a moment to do that, church. To seek Him. To exchange with Him.
Holy, holy, are you, Lord God Almighty? Says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. This morning, Jesus is in this place. But whether you sense his presence or not, whether you see him in this moment or not, he is here. He is your way, your truth, and your life. And right now, we have an opportunity to turn our eyes upon the living God. The God who loves you. The God who is for you. The God who made a way where there was no way. And we have a chance right now to come into his presence and say, God, Jesus, you are so worthy. You are so worthy of my all. God, we are sorry for the times where we have set our eyes and our focus upon the things that are not worthy of our time and our focus and our energy and our effort. God, I'm sorry for the times where I look upon myself and my own flesh and my own strength to accomplish and do things that I think I need to do to find worthiness in you. And yet, Jesus, you are our way. You are our truth. You are our life. We are made worthy through through Jesus Christ. And for that, right now in this moment, regardless of our experience of you in our past, we choose to take captive our thoughts and set them on you, Lord Jesus, to take this moment and give you praise for who you are and for what you have done in our life. God, we thank you that we can hand our future over to you, that we can know that your timing is perfect, that your ways are higher than our ways, your thoughts higher than our thoughts. And our eternal future, our eternal hope is in your hands. Church, let's just sing one more time, "Worthy is the Lord, Lamb, for he is our way, our truth, and our life."
Holy are you, Lord God Almighty. Worthy is the Lamb. Worthy is the Lamb. For you are holy. Holy. Are you, Lord God Almighty. Worthy is the Lamb. Worthy is the Lamb.
Lord God, we thank you so much for these times where we can gather in your presence, where we can join in the chorus of the angels in this moment, sing, "Forever you reign, forever you are worthy." And God, we are so grateful that we can gather as a church and lift high the name of Jesus. So God, we ask that you continue to just speak and move in this place. We make ourselves available to you for you to have your way. Lord God, speak through the word. Continue to speak through our praise and our worship, Lord God. We just want to give you glory this morning. In Jesus' mighty name, amen, amen, amen. Give God a hand this morning. It is so good to be praising, to be worshiping. We want to welcome you to church this day and welcome to anyone joining us online as well. We're going to stay in an attitude of worship as we come around the communion table now. So I'm going to welcome Josh Blacker. Josh is one of our leaders at Frontline. He's going to come and share communion with us this morning.
Thanks, Maddie. If the team could distribute the elements, that would be fantastic. Give me 1 second. How's everyone going today? Great. Everyone's going great. That's so good. Give me 1 sec. So, in preparation for communion, I wanted to find the value of why Jesus gave this as an instruction for myself personally and for us as believers to follow. In so many ways, communion is very straightforward. Jesus gave us communion so we'd be reminded of the testimony of the cross, so that all of us alike can be saved and shown to a holy calling. Communion is the giant street sign that reminds us as believers of the road to our salvation. For me, the symbol of communion as a pointer to the cross is so significant, as God specifically gave us signs before and after his death and resurrection. For me, a clear sign of God's plan to give us Jesus as our sacrifice is Isaiah 53, and I'll read from verses 3-7. He was despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. And as one from whom men hide their faces, he was despised, and we esteemed him not. Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows, yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgressions, he was crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the chastisement that brought us peace, and by his wounds we are healed. All we are like sheep and have gone astray. We have turned every one to his own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet he opened not his mouth. Like a lamb he is led to the slaughter, and like a sheep that before its shearers is silent, so he opened not his mouth. By his oppression and his judgment he was taken away. For me, this scripture has been a stronghold of my faith, an unequivocal piece of evidence of Jesus being the Christ, something that pointed straight to him. As a hugely prominent prophecy of the Messiah that came 500 years before his death and resurrection. A prophecy that talks of our Savior being atoned, hated, and the carrier of sorrows has a powerful place in the identity of Jesus in my heart. The correlation we see through the scripture and how it aligns with Jesus' description in what we are to remember when taking communion is also evident, even down to how Jesus instructs us. Sorry, I have airlines as an autocorrect here. Even down to how it aligns with Jesus' instructions for communion during the Passover, as we see in Luke. And I'll read from chapter 22, 19 and 20, and we'll draw the parallels. And he took the bread and gave it and broke it and gave it to them, saying, "This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And Isaiah says, "He was crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the chastisement that brought us peace, and by his wounds we are healed." And verse 20 says, "In the same way, after the supper, he took the cup, saying, 'This is the new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for you.' He was pierced for our transgressions. Like sheep, we have gone astray. We have turned everyone to their own way." These verses draw clear links, not only between the prophecy of Jesus and communion, but in the instruction, but also the events of the crucifixion. This leads us into when we do communion. We're instructed to hold memory of Jesus' suffering for us and how it saved us. When we reflect inwards, how do you respond in the moment? Do you have a feeling of gratitude for what Christ has done? Or maybe humility that we are only saved through faith in him? Some of us are half asleep when participating in communion. However, that's just in the moment. What about the moments that follow, the rest of your Sunday? Do you have gratitude through your week? Do you carry the same humility with how you treat others? This is not an attempt to be self-righteous. I forget these things just as quickly as the next person. So communion is a sign that points us as believers back to Jesus in reflection. Don't let it be a place where we just think about how it makes us feel. Let it be a place where we can think about how we too can point back to the cross. We can do this through how Jesus instructs us as his followers to be loving. John 18, 34 to 35 says, "A new command I give to you, love one another as I have loved you. So you must love one another. By this everyone you will know that you are my disciples, that if you love one another." So, as we all take the elements in our own time, I encourage you all to think of Jesus and his sacrifice for us and how we can reflect Jesus in the way that we live and how we love others, but also by how we serve, how we evangelize, and how we carry our spiritual disciplines. Feel free to take the elements in your own time. Time that we share as believers. I pray that we would remember the power of the elements and the power of what you've done for us. I pray that you would remind us that we are made perfect in weakness only through you, God, and that we can only follow you through your Holy Spirit. And thank you for the congregation. Amen.
Thank you, Josh. Yeah, give Josh a hand for leading us. Thank you very much. You can pass your glasses to the end of the row and the hospitality team will come and collect those. And while they're doing that, why don't you take 60 seconds just to say hello to someone around you, introduce yourself to someone that you haven't met before. You can grab your seats again if you haven't already. Good job. Has everyone had a good weekend? Good weekend so far? Yes. This is how I know if people are paying attention, if you answer my questions. The priests are paying attention. Thank you, guys. Well done. All right. You can continue those conversations after church. Why don't you make your way to your seats? We would love to welcome anyone who is new or visiting today. Shh. How can you welcome the people who are new and visiting if you're still talking? Can we give a hand to all those who are new and visiting this morning? Thank you for being with us. And as well, if you are visiting online, it's wonderful to have you join us for this service. If you are new, we would love for you to fill out one of these cards. You can find them at the stairwells or at the information tables as well, just so that we can introduce ourselves if we don't get a chance to after the service and let you know a little bit more about the life of the church as well. And it will help you get to know a little bit more about what we are about here at LMC as well. There's also a QR code in your notice sheet if you'd like to do it that way. Tonight, we have church tonight, very excited for our 6 p.m. service, our village night. So young adults, come on out, but everyone in the church, come on out. It's going to be a wonderful evening in church. Dan Gashk is speaking in person only. And then young adults, the village night continues with dinner at Ora to Oro in Croydon. And I don't think you need an RSVP, do you? You just come along. It's going to be fantastic. So have dinner after the service tonight, and it's going to be wonderful. Giving, thank you, church, for your obedience to giving. And let's continue to be encouraged by the fact that God wants to use us. And God, we get to participate when it comes to giving and when it comes to our tithes and our offering. And so let's continue to pray as to what God might put on our heart, not only to give, but of our finances and our money, but also what God calls us to give with our time and our effort and our energy around church as well. And so you can give online via direct deposit, BPAY, or fill out and drop out an envelope in the letterbox downstairs or to the info table as well. We're going to throw to a video and then Lauren's going to come and explain it afterwards. So thanks, guys.
Morning, church, and specifically good morning to the young adults, but also for those of you in our congregation that might have young adults as a part of your family as well. We encourage you to invite them along to this. This is a young adult series called What No One Ever Told You, and it's an in-depth series about discussing the biblical truths around sex, sexuality, and relationships. And we're really excited to be presenting this for you. And my main encouragement from the stage this morning is for the young adults out here to save the date of Sunday, the 19th of May. get it off work, get it off your rosters, make sure your assignments are done. From 2 to 5 p.m., we have Dr. Emma Wood coming down. She is from Canberra. She is a Christian, but also a philosopher in moral and sexual ethics. And she is a lecturer at the Campion University, a faith-based university in New South Wales. But she is also a research fellow at Women's Forum Australia as well. And she is a really passionate educator in this area. And she loves just to talk about the perspective of how we have developed an understanding of sex and sexuality. And then she wants to challenge that by bringing in a healthy, God-based understanding of sex and sexuality. So it's going to be a really great series, a really in-depth series. And we just want to make sure that we are addressing the issues that you guys actually care about, the issues and questions that you have in these areas, so that you can equip them into your own lives and the relationships that you have as well. And so it's a really important series. It's a really great series. Obviously, Sunday the 19th of May, that is part one with Dr. Emma Wood. And then there'll be two other parts to this series as well. But it's going to be a really life-giving series. And we encourage you just to save the dates. No registration is required, so just come along and enjoy the series. Thanks.
Thanks, Lauren. Does anyone think of something in their own life of what no one ever told you? Anyone else's mind? I went to when I got married and I was 22, and my parents never told me that you needed gas and electricity. I thought you needed one or the other. That was something that no one ever told me. I was only 22, so I've learned a lot since then. We're going to throw to another video now. Another video.
Marriage involves two people. They meet.
You found me really attractive, really quickly.
They fall in love.
She's passionate.
They get married and embark on a relationship that's designed to be one of increasing intimacy.
I really couldn't see my life without her.
But that's not automatic. We have to keep working at our marriage.
Because I wasn't getting much affirmation, I started getting that from other places.
Our marriage was nearly over.
If you start building good habits in your relationship, you'll be reaping the effects of those choices in 5, 10, or 20 years' time.
I can't let my past define my future. We have to build our own reality.
The aim of the marriage course is to strengthen the connection between you as a couple.
Love grows us. This is not a silly sentimental idea. This is science fact.
How about one that we don't really hear about? How about this one? Fun. Marriage ought to be fun. If you're not having fun, what's the point?
The marriage course is built on universal principles that are relevant to any couple anywhere. In years to come, you'll look back on having built a marriage as perhaps the most important achievement of all in your lives.
Wonderful. So this is a new opportunity, a really unique course, which I'll encourage you to have a think about and look into. Starting on Thursday, May 9th, it's run over 8 consecutive weeks on Thursday evenings, and it's actually an online course. So it's not in person, it's online via Zoom. And it's a series designed to help couples invest in their relationship based on biblical and Christian principles. It is for any married couple looking to build a better and stronger marriage, whatever stage of life they are in. And actually, it's unique in that couples are not actually invited to share anything about their relationship. It's actually entirely private between your husband and wife. So the cost is $60 per couple, which includes the workbooks that you get and the cost of the course. So more details and information can be found on Church Centre, and that is where you can sign up as well. But if you have any questions about that, come and see Nick down the front or any of us, and we can point you in the right direction as well. So I encourage you to consider that and pray about it and sign up if that's something that you would love to do. Be the Love, you can still continue to sign up for the Term 2 Meals rosters. We've still got some places for that on the Church Centre app. And also we are collecting, as you may have seen, downstairs in the foyer, we're collecting canned goods for Siri, baked beans, tinned spaghetti, soups and tuna. It would all be appreciated. So when you go into the shops this week, perhaps if you can throw in a couple of extra cans, that would be wonderful, so we can take them off and bless the community with that. So it's just down in the foyer. If you have any of those, you can put the cans down on that table down there. Frontline Church is on today, so year 7s to 9s. We launched on Friday night. It was fantastic to be back for Term 2, and I know kids were back in a strong way as well. So Frontline Church, you can follow Holly down the stairs there. And while they're doing that, just a quick note for the church. LMC AGM is on next Sunday after church. Reminder to those that can't attend to get their proxies in by Friday as well. That is all from me. I'm going to hand over to Pastor Andy, who's going to share the word. Let's welcome him as he comes.
Thanks, Maddie. Thanks, Matt, and good morning, church. It's so great to see you here today, and a big hello and good morning to everyone who's watching with us online, whether it is live now or whether you're watching later down the track. We thank you so much for joining us for church. It is a joy. It is a joy to do life with all of you here as part of church community, where it's not just about enjoying all the different things that we get to do together, but it's about growing in our faith. It's about growing in our relationship with God. It's about worshiping Him together as a community, and that's what it is. It really is all about Him. Where's Gavin Russell Rockliffe? Are you here, Gav? Where are you? Happy birthday, Gav! Today, Gavin has turned 20. Gavin's kids are normally nearly 22. Gavin did not turn 22 today, but happy birthday, Gav. Hope you have a great day. Thanks for coming to church on your birthday. Well done, mate. Also, Anzac Day is obviously this coming Thursday, this week as well. And if any of you are interested in joining us for a dawn service, Oxley Christian College are hosting a dawn service up at the school. Turn right as soon as you come in the gate and you will be able to join the students as they lead us in a dawn service on Anzac Day this Thursday. I want to start, is it Wednesday? Is Anzac Day Wednesday? I'm just getting, it's the service is on Wednesday. Right. That makes sense. The service is going to be on Wednesday morning at 6:45 a.m. However, Anzac Day is indeed Thursday. So, glad we clarified that. We're going to pray this morning before we get started. I want to pray just before we get into the Word of God. We're going to pray for what's happening in the Middle East right now. Obviously, you would be hopefully aware of what's happening in the news with Israel and just the whole region over there and the conflict that's going on. And we really need to continue to pray for that whole region. Pray for the Christians that are in that region, that they would be kept safe, that they would be able to share the truth of the Word of God with those who desperately need it over there. And pray that God's will be done. Pray for peace. Pray for the leaders of the nations. Pray for those who are all involved, that they would humble their hearts before our living God. Let's just pray right now. Father God, as we stand here and we consider everything that's going on overseas and the conflict that's over there, we acknowledge that it is hard for us to stand here or sit here today and think that there's anything that we can really do to make a difference. But Father God, as we acknowledge that, it is not us, but it is You that can make the difference. And so, Holy God, we pray that You would have Your way in that region. Father, we pray for the safekeepings of all of the Christians in that area. Father, that they would be protected, Lord, that they would have the ability to share Your word and Your truth, the hope that they have in Jesus Christ, who came to this earth and died for humanity, that they might have life beyond this life here on earth. Father, that they would fall in love with You afresh. Lord, we pray for the leaders of the nations. We pray for those who have influence in that space. Lord God, we pray that You would turn their hearts towards You, that You would change the direction that they are heading right now. Father God, we pray over all of that Your will be done. We trust You. You are a sovereign God, and we trust You in all the situations that are happening there. So Lord God, we give You glory. We give You glory, and we thank You that you are indeed in control. And Lord, as we come to this day and as You open Your word, we acknowledge the same about our own lives. You are sovereign. You are in control. And so we submit ourselves before You right now. As we open Your word, we open our hearts that You might have Your way in us, that You might be glorified through the way that we live, through the way that we act, through the way that we think, through the way that we speak, Lord God, that we might reflect Your glory and reflect Your Son, Jesus. So have Your way in us this day, we pray in Jesus' name. And everyone said, amen, amen. The title of my message today, if you're writing notes, is The Glory of God. This is a subject that I have wanted to take on for a little while now. But it wasn't until I started my study that I realized that I was potentially ill-equipped to come across this topic because of how huge and how significant it is. And understanding the significance of this subject for us as Christians really is critical. We sing so often about the glory of God in our songs, nearly every Sunday. We read so often about the glory of God right throughout Scripture, from the beginning right through to the end. Our prayers are filled, like I just prayed, with those type of statements, that God, you would be glorified. But do we really understand the significance of that which we are singing, reading, or praying? What is the glory of God? This is an important question. However, it's not one that is simple for me to answer in a statement up here, but we're going to try as we open God's word today. I heard it said this way when it came to describing the glory of God. Describing the glory of God to someone is similar in manner to me trying to describe to you what beauty is in comparison to describing to you what a basketball is. If I was to say, if you were to say, Andy, what is a basketball? And you have no other context, I'm going to explain to you that it is a ball. It's made of synthetic leather, and you blow it up, and it's about this size, and generally they're bright orange in color, and they have some black markings on them, and when you drop them, they bounce up to you again. And with that, you would have a pretty good understanding of the definition of a basketball. What is a basketball? I've just defined it for you. However, with beauty, if you didn't have any context of what beauty is, and you asked me, explain to me what is the meaning of that word, how would I do that? I mean, I would start realistically by asking my wife to stand up. Beauty is that. Oh. Love you. Love you. Beauty. Beauty. Right there on the front row. Beauty. For some of you, you would take me up, or I would take you up onto a mountaintop, and I would give you a view, and you would look, and I'd say, that is beautiful. That is a beautiful view. For others, it would be about nature, and you would get a flower, and you'd look at that and say, that is beautiful. Or you know, for animal lovers, it's the beauty of a baby animal. It's like, wow, that is so beautiful. It's different. But overall, over a period of time, you would learn what beauty is as we simply walk around and as I point, as I go, that right there, that is what beauty is. Or in contrast or comparison to that, this is what beauty is. And it's similar when it comes to the glory of God. Though it's difficult for us to explain, as we live and as we open the Word of God and see what it says, we allow the Word of God to point and say, here is what the glory of God is. This is what the glory of God looks like. And we end up having a reference point. We experience the glory of God, and that is also what leads us to understanding what it is. And so today, to the best of my ability in this moment, I'm going to open God's word with you that we might gain revelation of God's glory. And out of that, here's the purpose, that out of that we would deepen our worship of Him. There is a saying, and it's actually the title of an old Bon Jovi song called Blaze of Glory. I remember that song, Blaze of Glory. To go out in a blaze of glory is something it's to do something very dramatic before your last moments or before you even finish something. But as we're learning, and you know, through that terminology and the point of this, what are we saying? We're saying, if I'm going to go out in a blaze of glory, in those moments, I'm going to do something so dramatic that it's going to bring a certain amount of fame or a certain amount of glory my way. It's about me going out in a blaze of glory. But as we've been learning this year through this theme that we have on the walls here, worship the One, we're created for something so much more than the potential increase of our own fame or glory. And so often we can live our lives so that we can endeavor to, and this is what, you know, obviously the internet has been able to do, is to create those avenues of fame, those avenues where the glory is coming towards me. But the truth is that we have been all created to participate in glory, but not the glory of ourselves, but the glory of the One. And for that reason, whether you live where your glory is increasing or your fame is increasing or not, it doesn't matter because our lives are not insignificant. And there can be this lie that perpetuates society that if you don't have this level of achievement or this level of fame or glory coming your way, then you are insignificant. But that is not the truth when we see it through this lens, because we are participating in glory, but glory of the King. And therefore, none of us are insignificant as we participate in that glory. As we open the Word, we'll see that the glory of God is mentioned in many different ways. And though overall they can be categorized in these two ways, we have, number one, God's intrinsic glory. And secondly, on the screen, you'll see we have His extrinsic or His ascribed glory. The first part, God's intrinsic glory, is basically the sum and the substance of all that He is and all that He does. The glory belongs to God and belongs to God alone, which we will read. It's linked to His holiness, and in many ways it's seen to be the manifest evidence of His holiness is His glory. Something that we can know, something that we can see. And then there's the ascribed glory, and this is what we give to God. It's a beholding of His intrinsic glory. And in many ways, it's our response in worship to the intrinsic glory of God. So what does the Bible say? Well, it's important as we open Scripture today to know that the glory of God is used in the Bible as both an adjective, a noun, and as a verb. So God is glorious as an adjective describing who He is. We see His glory revealed as a noun, and it's also that He is to be glorified as a verb, as a doing word. So the first point is this, as we see it. Glory is His manifest presence. The glory of God, His manifest presence. And we're going to move to the book of Exodus. So if you've got your Bibles or your devices, please turn with me to Exodus, and we're going to read from chapter 13. And the setup here is that the Israelites, under the leadership of Moses, have departed from Egypt, and they're making their way towards the promised land. And they're now in the wilderness season. And Exodus 13, 21 to 22 is what we're going to read. It says, "And the Lord went before them by day in a pillar of cloud to lead them along the way, and by night in a pillar of fire to give them light, that they might travel by day and by night. The pillar of cloud by day and the pillar of fire by night did not depart from before the people." What does that mean, Andy? Where's the glory of God in that? Well, we see another picture of the cloud, which has gone up Mount Sinai with Moses when God is giving him the Ten Commandments in Exodus 24:17. "Now the appearance of the glory of the Lord was like a devouring fire on the top of the mountain in the sight of the people of Israel." And lastly, we've got these pictures. And lastly, we come to the point where the tabernacle has been fully completed. So all of the specifications that God has given him, it says Moses has finally completed the tabernacle. And then this happens in Exodus 40, 34 to 38. If you flick across to Exodus 40, verse 34, "Then the cloud covered the tabernacle, and the glory of the Lord filled the tabernacle. Moses could no longer enter the tabernacle because the cloud had settled down over it, and the glory of the Lord filled the tabernacle. Now, whenever the cloud lifted from the tabernacle, the people of Israel would set out on their journey following it. But if the cloud did not rise, they remained where they were until it lifted. The cloud of the Lord hovered over the tabernacle during the day, and at night fire glowed inside the cloud so that the whole family of Israel could see it. This continued throughout all of their journeys." The presence of the Lord, the glory of the Lord, His manifest presence. We see the value that the Israelites and Moses had on the presence of the Lord. And I was talking to Sam. You see Sam? I was talking to Sam this week. We were talking about this passage, well, not this passage specifically, but the nature of the Israelites' relationship to God, where when the presence of God was there, we stay put. When the presence of God moves, we move. And that Moses' refusal, that God said, "You need to go. Go to the promised land. Take the people, but I'm not going with you. I might destroy you, but the promised land's yours. Go." And Moses says, I ain't going anywhere. If you're not going to be there, I ain't going. And that is the same, that is the same attitude we need to take on through our lives right now. God, if you're not there, I don't want it. When it comes to the job offering that we get or whatever it is that is offered to us in life, God, if you're not in it, I don't want it. I don't want it. I don't want to be apart from your presence. Exodus 33, we also read of Moses asking this question of God. God, please show me your glory. And God does this, but he has to hide Moses in the corner of a rock. And it says that as the Lord passes by Moses, God has to put his hand over Moses' face. Because if Moses was to see the Lord's face, he would surely die. And so the first slice of the pie for you as we fill out what the glory of God is that it is his manifest presence, the glory of God. The word glory, most popularly translated in the Old Testament, is the Hebrew word kabod, which has the root meaning of being of weight or of heaviness to describe the glory of the Lord in these instances. So his manifest presence. The second part is this, the glory of the Lord displayed throughout creation. And secondly, we have this explained to us that the God's glory is on display. We see his glory in creation. We see it in his image bearers as we look around. We see it in his providence. We see it in his redemptive acts. And Psalm 19:1 says this, what an awesome scripture. The heavens declare the glory of God, and the sky above proclaims his handiwork. In other words, do you want to see the glory of God? Then go outside at nighttime and find a space and look. Look up and see the glory of God. What do you mean? I'm looking at stars. That's exactly right. See, sometimes I think we fall into the trap, and Dave, thank you for sharing that word this morning, that interpretation of the tongue this morning. We fall into this trap of fostering a small God mentality, where for me and the way I live, my God is simply a small God who comes along and helps me out in the different things that I have in life. God, I need some help with this area of my life, so can you please give me some assistance? God ain't no butler, right? He ain't no butler. You know, do we think he's working in a few areas of my life and be others, but surely he isn't above everything. But that isn't the God of the Bible that we serve. Dave's word was an encouragement to us today. God is a big God, which we'll get to. A few weeks ago, some of you might be aware, and Pastor Graham's not here this morning. He's watching at home. He's a little bit crook. He's okay, though. He's okay. He's just having a little bit of time, isn't he? Just recovering. It's okay, Pastor Graham. You'll be okay. He would be excited about this, because a few weeks ago, SpaceX launched their most recent Starship rocket. Who knows what the Starship rocket is? Does anybody? Okay, not many. All right. This is a prototype spacecraft that has the eventual goal of taking man back to the moon and eventually taking man to Mars. Whether that's going to happen or not, who knows? It is the largest and most powerful rocket that has ever been built. And you can play that. Thanks, guys. I've got some image, some vision of that on the screen as I talk about it. This rocket, for context, if you were to look up at the TV towers on the top of Mount Dandenong, this is pretty much the size of that rocket. So if you can imagine that taking off, and this happened a few weeks ago, their third ever try at this. There is such an incredible amount of advanced engineering that has gone into this thing to make it fly as it does. And every time I watch one of these things go up, there is a moment, and you'll see it as it takes off and as it... The sound waves down the bottom and it makes its way through the clouds. Like the weight of that thing lifting off the ground is absolutely incredible. It's crazy that it's actually doing that. Gets to this point where they split apart in the air and the top stage then goes off and orbits the Earth. But it's when you get to some of these shots like you see here where you see the Earth back down from up so high that it gives you such a different perspective, like floating around the Earth like this. What a different perspective. We can marvel at it, and I love how it changes. You know, when you hear astronauts that have gone up to space onto the International Space Station and they look down, They speak about those images and they say, my perspective has so changed. The way that I think about the world in which we live has changed. But that perspective changes even more the further you look. And this next image I want to show you is from a place called the Goods North Field. That's the image, what it's called. And I want to help you pull back a little bit further. This image was taken by the James Webb Telescope. The James Webb Telescope went up a few years ago and is kind of the next Hubble telescope, if you've heard of Hubble. And so more advanced and can see a little bit differently. And they took this photo. What you can see here is actually about 15,000 different little items as part of this image. At least the Hubble version had that number in it. Normally, if you were to go outside on a dark night and look up at the stars, you would see approximately 6,000 stars up there in the sky. But here we have more than double that. But the truth is that these aren't actually stars that you're looking at in this picture. And if you go to the next slide, I'm going to give you a zoom shot of this little bit here, the next slide. These are actually 15,000 galaxies of stars in this image. We are part of the Milky Way galaxy here on Earth. And it's estimated that our galaxy itself has approximately 100 billion stars in it. And right here, you see 15,000 galaxies of approximately 100 billion stars in them. And I want to take you one step further, because this image that you're seeing, you can go back to that first one, this image that you're seeing represents one image, one square, as the telescope points out, in about 24 million that would be able to be seen. 1/24 millionth of what we could see out in the sky. The heavens declare the glories of God. The sky above proclaims his handiwork. The glory of the Lord is found in what we can see, in the vastness of the universe, the size of which is incomprehensible to us. That's why it's so hard to compare these types of things with things that we can understand in our minds. The closest we get to that is this, that if you were to take that same basketball that we talked about at the start of the message, and you were to drive all the way out, about 120 kilometers out to Ballarat, and you were to set that basketball down on the ground, and you were to drive back and look at that basketball from here, that is the size of that 1/24 millionth image that we see of 15,000 galaxies of 100 billion stars. Incomprehensible. The big God that we serve, that is God over the whole universe, decided to send his son to this earth to save us, his people. Look up, church, look out and see the glory of God. So the glory of God represented through creation. The third thing is this that we need to know is God's glory is God's alone. Isaiah 42:8. Says, I am the Lord, that is my name. My glory I give to no other. My glory I give to no other, nor my praise to carved idols. I thought about this in light of when Nick and Aaron shared a few weeks ago about idolatry. No one compares to the Lord, and his glory will be given to no other. And this truth stems out of the knowledge that we already have from a few weeks ago of the holiness of God. That God is holy means that God is set apart. There is no other. Out of his holiness come his love. Out of his holiness come his grace. Out of his holiness comes his justice and his response to justice. His attributes. What the scripture is saying here in Isaiah is that the glory that is due his name will be directed to no other place. Not to human hands. Not to some false gods. And if we look forward a couple of chapters in Isaiah 48:11, we read here God's reasoning behind his persistence of Israel and why he would save them from destruction. And it says in verse 11, for my own sake I do it. For how should my name be profaned? My glory I will not give to another. God's glory It's God's alone. You know, last week we heard from Pastor Pete about his experiences at the beginning of the year and how it's seen by him, as he looks back, to be an overwhelming net positive for him because of the constant revelation he's had of God's love throughout this time. And as I was thinking about this week and speaking with someone else about it, we were acknowledging that it's much easier for us to see God's protection for us when there's been an incident or something that we notice. But there's so many times in our lives where we just don't know. You know, I was thinking about times in my life where, you know, if there's a ball around, a ball is there to be thrown. And so you've just got to throw it to someone. And then someone, you know, I don't know, you know those people, like, you're throwing a ball around and then someone catches the ball and they stand there with the ball and they then just start talking to someone and you're like, come on, do you know what I'm talking about, Matt? Yeah, there are those people around. If a ball comes to you, throw it back. Like, there's a tip. And sometimes we're in those moments and we're throwing a ball around with a group of friends. I don't know if you've seen this before, but you throw it to someone and it leaves your arm and then you see the trajectory of this thing and there's someone's head, like, is about to walk into frame. And what happens, this ball or whatever it is that you've thrown, hopefully it's not something dangerous, just slides past. And everybody around just goes, oh. And the person who it slid past, they just keep on walking. They are oblivious to what has just happened in their life. You know, people are sitting down and it's one of those ones as well where you throw it and someone's there and someone just reaches out and catches it before it hits a person. And everyone's like, wow, what a catch. But the person just goes on with the conversation they were having and they don't know what happened at all. And I think about that in light of what we're talking about here. And so often we can give glory to God and we think about what happened with Pete and we see the way God was at work and we understand his provision as we look back and we don't get the full picture, but we get part of it and we go, thank you, God. Thank you for what you did. Thank you for what we saw. But do we have that in our minds that we say every day, God, thank you so much for all of the things that you have protected me from that I have no idea about right now? I look at that in my life as in my teenage years, and I say, God, thank you so much for what you steered me away from what you protected me from through those years. God, thank you so much for those near misses in my life that I don't even have an idea about that even happened. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for your provision. Thank you for your guidance. Thank you for your protection in my life. All glory to you, God, not just because of what I know, but be glory to you because of the way that you are at work, even in the spaces that I do not know. See, the truth is we are right now living testimonies of the providence of God. Who are we to thank that we live today? Who are we to thank for the air that we breathe? Who are we to praise for the hope that we have in the future? God's glory is for no one else but God alone. And these scriptures and these points about God's glory today are in no way exhaustive, but they're only, in fact, scratching the surface. And I have one more for us today. As we've learnt, the glory of God is His alone. And I've titled this one, The Glory of God, Worship the One. Is that what I said? Worship the One. I changed it around a few times. Worship the One. If God's glory is God's glory alone, and really it's the goal of all things, it is His presence here on earth and it can be experienced by us. The glory of God, in trying to get this into a single definition, the glory of God is the going public of His holiness. And finally, we want to see today that by experiencing the glory of God, we are never the same. We are never the same. And the only worthy response to the glory of God is to worship. I acknowledge it's unusual to speak about the Christmas story in April, but Steph did it last Sunday night, and I'm going to do it again today. There are so many of these passages that we have read time and time again, but I want you to think on it in light of what we have just learned. In Luke 2, I'm going to read from Luke 2, 8 to 14. Many of you would know it. And in the same region, there were shepherds out in the field, keeping watch over their flock by night, just chilling out, minding their own business. And an angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them. and then they were filled with great fear. When we think about this, it's easy to imagine that the angel has just like popped up out of nowhere. But when you think about, you know, as a kid, when I used to think about where is heaven, where would I, if I asked you where is heaven, what would we do? We would point upwards, right? We would point upwards. But the angel didn't just come out of thin air. The angel came from somewhere. And we look at the, just as we have of the rockets and the going up into space and the vastness of the universe. And this angel coming from heaven with the glory of the Lord, like it's just right here in front of these shepherds, and the glory of the Lord is known and is felt with the angel having come from the presence of God. And they just stand, they fall down with great fear. And in verse 10, the angel said to them, "Fear not, for behold, I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all the people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior who is Christ the Lord. And this will be a sign for you. You will find a baby wrapped in swaddling clothes." I deleted the scripture where it came from, where it talks about Christ being the glory of God. The glory of God we see in the sky and His handiwork and the expanse of the universe, and the glory of God found lying in a manger in swaddling clothes. And then suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of heavenly hosts praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace amongst those with whom He is pleased." And for the angels who know the living God and His Son, their response is to worship. And the feature of that worship is glory to God in the highest. And then incredibly, and peace on earth for us, for those with whom He is pleased. Glory to God. It's all about Him. Glory to God. And then there's good news for you too. The good news of the gospel is it's all about Him. Glory to God. And then it's great news for us. And it has to be in that order. It's always in that order. This is why having an understanding of the glory of God is so important to our knowledge of God, because it keeps things in the right order. 1 Corinthians 10:31 says, "So whatever you eat or drink, or whatever you do, do all to the glory of God." Sometimes we can get in this frame of mind, I think, the way we can switch on or off this attitude towards the glory of God. One example I've seen for this is, is a few guys in this church, and look, basketball's coming up in this message, is on that basketball court. And there's guys that when the competitive juices get flowing, and then when the body is not doing what the mind says it should do, they become frustrated. And their character changes. And they have a crack. And they say things that they wish they shouldn't have said. They do things which they are out of their character when they enter onto that basketball court. I'm looking to a few of you guys right now. I know who you are. But for some of you, it's like there's the Sunday you. And then there's the Monday you. And then there's the Saturday night you. And they're all different people. Like, we know how to behave to fit in all of these different situations. Maybe there's the workplace you, which is different from the family you, which is different from the church attender you. But this scripture speaks to the truth of what God expects from us as our response to Him and His holiness, is that in whatever we do it for the glory of God. And this is not, I will do what I think is best, or I will maybe put myself in a compromising position and then say, God, please come and help me as I've put myself in this position. Because if we do it that way, we're getting the order wrong. It is that I have decided that in all things, with all areas of my life, that I will do all for the glory of God, for He is worthy. And so in closing, I want to ask you a question today, and if I can have the team come up, that would be great. Why have you decided to make God part of your life? Why are you a Christian? If you had someone come up to you from work, your neighbor, and they asked you this question, why are you a Christian? Why do you follow God? What would you say? Some of us don't have that opportunity all the time where we get to verbalize why it is we love God. But often people are watching to see if your life represents what you say, that I love and I honor God. And for some of you, life hasn't been perfect. And when I think about Pastor Pete's story, we were praying so hard, our team, that God would save Pastor Pete's life. We were praying that he would make a full recovery. We prayed that over and over again. For those who were there in that moment, there was a lot of prayer going on for Pastor Pete. And glory to God for what he has done. Glory to God. Glory to God. But at the same time, I'm aware for some of you that it hasn't worked out that way. That you've prayed and perhaps someone has passed away. Or you've prayed and you've ended up losing your business. Or you've prayed and you're praying and someone's not getting better, but they might be getting worse. And this is where that question leads to the rubber hitting the road of our faith. Do I believe in God because of what He can do in my life that I can't do? Is my belief in God about me? Or do I believe and follow God because He is worthy to be glorified? And your answer to that question matters. Because you will face trial, and you will face difficulty, and you will face blessing. And if you flipped or inverted your theology to say that it's all about my life before it's all about God's glory, then we're going to see all of these experiences through the wrong lens. Because the reality is this, that God was God before you and I were here on the earth. The reality is that God's ways are much higher than our ways, and His thoughts are much higher than our thoughts. And my confidence in all of those situations is not shaken in my God, who is unfathomably big, no matter the circumstances I face. This is that big God theology that we need to maintain, which leads us to going, the glory is going to no one else here but to Him. Glory to God in the highest. Glory to God in the highest. I want to finish by reading Romans 11, 33 to 36, and then the team are going to lead us in the song, Worthy of It All. You are worthy of it all. Romans 11, 33 to 36 from the New Living Translation says this. Oh, how great are God's riches and wisdom and knowledge. How impossible it is. Can you stand as I read this, please? Come on, this is so good. This is so good for us today. Let's read it together, church. Oh, how great are God's riches and wisdom and knowledge. How impossible it is for us to understand His decisions and His ways. For who can know the Lord's thoughts? Who knows enough to give Him advice? And He who has given Him so much that he needs to pay it back. For everything comes from him and exists by his power and is intended for his glory. All glory to him forever. Amen. For from him and through him and to him are all things. To God be given the glory. Now, where you get to experience the glory of God, which is such an incredible thing for us to fathom. When we read about the angels singing, we've sung it this morning, holy, holy, holy. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. What did they say after that? Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. The whole earth is filled with his glory. The whole earth is filled with his holiness. The whole earth is filled with his glory that we get to experience today in the presence of God. So, Heavenly Father, as we just maybe just catch a glimpse of your glory as we've seen read through your word, as we see your presence that was evidence to the Israelites back then, that is evidence to us today by the work of the Holy Spirit on the earth and in our lives, as we become more aware of your glory, as we look to the heavens and as we look to the skies, as we understand the big God that you are, that we serve. Father, as we line that all up with the way that we see our lives today and as we see the circumstances, we decide to worship you as our response, that we bring glory to your name. Not just for what you have done and the things that we see you do, but God, for who you are. You are worthy of it all. You are worthy of it all. Jesus, we love you. We thank you that you are representation. You are the glory of God. You deserve the glory. You deserve the glory. Come on, church, let's sing. You're worthy of it all.
You're worthy of it all.
Come on, from your hearts to him.
For from you are all things, and to you are all things.
You deserve it, Lord.
You deserve the glory.
Oh, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord.
You're worthy of it all.
Thank you, Lord. We thank you and we praise you today.
You're worthy of it all.
For who you are. We thank you for choosing us, Lord, to be your people.
For from you are all things, and to you are all things.
Oh, we praise your name. We praise you.
You deserve the glory.
Yes, you do all of it, Lord God. All of it. Our lives and all that we are. We
you
point towards
are
you. Jesus, have your way.
You are worthy of it all.
Holy God.
For from you are all things, and to you are all things. You deserve the glory.
Come on, keep singing. Keep singing. You're worthy. You're worthy.
You are worthy of it all.
God a hand this morning for who He is. He is worthy of our praise. You are so worthy, Jesus. Father God, we thank You so much for this word. We thank You that we can see the glory of God all around us. And God, we choose to see it within us as well. That, Lord God, You are filling us. You are taking us by Your strength. And that, Lord God, we can see and proclaim Your glory today. So, Father God, we choose not to just leave this word in this place, but, Father God, we will take it with us. Lord, we will choose to see Your glory each and every day. So, God, have Your way in and through us, we pray, that You may be glorified. In Jesus' mighty name, amen, amen, amen. Can we thank Pastor Andy for that word this morning? Encourage you to take it with you, remember it throughout your day, throughout your week, and let's encourage each other in it as well. We got church tonight, don't forget, 6 p.m., come out. It's going to be fantastic hearing Dan bring the word and a time of worship, and again, spend time in God's presence, glorifying our Father. So we'd love to see you there. Have a wonderful week, church, and we'll see you next week as well.